wonderful when the mission is.
Yes. Isn't it great to have music that really fits exactly where we are?
Amen.
That's kind of
and this is really something for us. We shouldn't be proud of people, but we should take some pride in this. Shall we?
It is amazing how many people have told me how much they like the look of the bus stop shelter.
It couldn't fit more perfectly.
It fits. They see it as fitting with our architecture,
yes.
With absolutely everything
the
about
church.
The church. So that's kind of neat.
It's beautiful.
It is attracting attention to the church. You know, the church that everybody drives by and nobody sees. So that's a good thing. Okay, next Sunday, the 7th of November, it's daylight savings time ends day, so we get an extra hour sleep. Thank you, God. It is also our celebration of All Saints. And one of the themes of All Saints, of course, is the great cloud of witnesses, all those who have gone before us in faith. And so we would ask you to bring pictures, framed or not framed, little, tiny, big, not huge. We don't need to bring anything. Of those who have led you, helped you, guided you along the Jesus way. They can be living or dead. They may be your relatives. They may be other people, depending on what pictures you have access to and who you have. But please bring them in. We'll collect them all on a table where we can see our own cloud of witnesses. The November calendar and newsletter are on the back table. Please be sure you take yours. The forward day by days are on the back table. You will need them starting tomorrow, so be sure to take one home. We're in good shape there. Next Sunday is the last time to bring anything in for the shoeboxes. Looking at the collection of stuff we have, I think we're almost there. But please feel free to get something in. Please talk to Joyce or Ruth if you have any questions. We already know the bishop is coming on the 13th. We will not be doing coffee hour again. The numbers last night reached a new high. We are now over 400, almost 450 cases per 100,000. And I did see an article saying that there have been outbreaks in Belfast, Friendship, and Cuba that are of particular note in the schools. And the big problem is the first symptom seems to be a runny nose. And all of us who've been parents, when did you ever keep your kids home because they had a runny nose but they felt fine? But that's been COVID breaking out and it's been very, very difficult for them.
And we're hearing across the nation it's plummeting, thank you, Jesus. But not.
We remember when everybody else was going up and we weren't?
Right.
We're just rolling behind.
We're honestly.
And I did notice last night, we are the worst county in New York State for COVID cases. Number two worst county is Cattaraugus. So Steuben's in the other direction is up a little bit, but it really is something we need to be careful about. Do we have any other announcements? Have I forgotten anything, Bill? Yes, I know. We had convention yesterday. Took us about
4 hours.
4 hours? It was actually 3.5. And Bill has a summary of what happened. It was, of course, our bishop's last convention. Come on, Bill, or stand up, whatever you prefer.
Try to keep it short and sweet.
I will say that convention on Zoom is more efficient in the sense of speed. But this is, what is it, the third year we've been on Zoom?
Third.
I will say that it just like when we were Zoom at church and Zoom for vestry, there is a little loss because you can't really, you know, talk with people and see what's going on as readily. But it is more efficient and saves us from driving early morning hours to get there. It opened at 8:30, but we had to be on by 7:30 on Zoom because there's, somewhere close to 200 people to be on Zoom. So it's quite a technical thing to make sure everybody's on and everybody's ready to vote or everybody's ready to go. So it started with a morning prayer by the bishop, and it was his last official time at convention. And at the end of the convention, they presented him with a bouquet of flowers. And I'm not sure what the present was, but it looked like it might have been a package of his favorite beverage. So after that, we started the business part. I won't go through all the names on the committees. I'll put this in the back for people to read. Buzz is still on from the last time, so he's still part of the diocesan team. But these people are all probably people you really don't know, but they filled the positions that were open. One thing that made it easier on Zoom yesterday, nobody was presented from the floor, and there was no more, there wasn't, like, if there was a position open and you only needed one, that's all that was on there. So we were able to not have to go into another computer system to vote electronically. They just passed everything with one vote through Zoom. So that was taken care of there. The bottom end of the budget, which probably, just to let you know, was that for 2022, the actual budget is $2 million, and without my glasses on, $98,112, which is important to us, is our apportionment this year, is $5,039. And last year's, it was $5,194. So our apportionment for this year is down from what it was. So it's a little easier on our pocketbook. And we had a few minutes break, and then we went to the bishops, who then presented his talk for his last session, thanking everybody for this, the support he was given for the last, what was it, 10 years, huh, 12 years?
14.
14, yeah. And then we went on to the resolutions. The first resolution was a resolution to change Canon 9, and what that amounts to, it really doesn't affect us necessarily, but what they have decided is that because of lawsuits and issues with the buildings, etc., the diocese, being the standing committee, will take the responsibility of making sure that every church has the proper coverage. And the reason we're not affected, and most churches aren't right now, is that we're insured under church insurance, which is also where the diocese, and they've already made sure that most churches, but it's been changed into Canon 9, where they'll be responsible to guide churches to make sure that we have proper coverage so that something happens that you're not buried with somebody filing a lawsuit or whatever. The other resolution was, unfortunately, Parish in Bloomfield, between COVID and other issues, financially weren't able to So what they brought up, this makes the eighth church since Bishop Singer's been there that we've had it closed. So there was somewhat discussion of we need to, that's not that many, but on the whole, we need to help support smaller churches. So that was quite a discussion around that when we brought that resolution to the floor. Okay. The other resolution, which everybody backed, and I don't know if anybody realizes, in Congress, James Clyburn has proposed, and there is a congressional bill supporting making Lift Every Voice and Sing the national hymn.
Not anthem.
Not anthem. That's why he wants to present it as the national hymn. It has been spoken as the black national anthem. But it was actually, there's quite a history on it. It was written by a person for Abraham Lincoln and his assassination, etc. So what they want to do is to formally make it the national hymn. And so we get back that resolution, and that will be sent to Congress saying that we're supportive of that. And of course, everybody knows that that's why our hymnal, Lift Every Voice and Sing, that's the first song in the hymnal. And it is one of many favorite songs.
I
want to
teach that soon, yeah. But like the Star Spangled Banner, it covers about three octaves. Now, my sopranos, for instance, cover an octave than a note. So, it's a little tricky, but.
And then, the last resolution was, of course, to present and elect our provisional bishop, who was Steve Lane, and that was passed. And if everybody's been here long enough, Steve Lane was the canon to the ordinary under Bishop McKelvey, and then was, I guess you would call it a promotion to Bishop of Maine. And he's been retired, I believe, now about 2 years, and he had moved back to Rochester. So he knows the diocese, so for a provisional bishop, while we're looking for a new bishop, it will work out real well because he knows us and can assist. So some of this paperwork, like I said, for the delegates that were voted into different positions on the diocesan level, I'll leave it in the back for anybody that's interested, or you can find it on the website. It'll be posted who's a member of what. Any questions? Okay.
Thank you, Tom. Our bishop, current bishop, is going to Michigan?
I guess he's a potential candidate. I don't think they've officially voted yet, but he's a candidate. He's the number one candidate for Eastern
and
Western Diocese of Michigan.
Their our loss is their blessing. Yeah.
Again, they have to do it. Even though we knew Steve Lane was probably a shoo-in, he has to be voted on in their convention before it's official.
Yeah.
Okay, as you can see, they crowded a lot into 3.5 hours.
Yes.
But it was nice, it was done, and that was really good. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries today? Pat, stay put, we'll do social distancing.
Sure.
Dear Lord, we give you thanks for Pat. And Lord, especially as she begins another year, we ask you to bless her. Shine your light on her, Lord, and guide her to reflect your light to the world all around her. May she have, according to your will, many more years to show us how to follow in your footsteps. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Ted?
Well, to begin UTO today, I want to thank my Lord and Savior for all the opportunities he has given me to serve him. Now, I'll admit there are times I'm not really thankful for those opportunities. But then I think of some precious words from from a hymn we have, the choir has sung for years, and we've practiced again this year. And those words are simply, Lord, I will follow if thou wilt but lead. And then very sheepishly, I realize that's what we're all supposed to do. So thanks be to God. This, by the way, is the last week of the month, so if you'd like to make a contribution on the way out today, feel free. Thank you.
I want to thank God that for the first time this past week, remember this is a new week today, the choir, the entire choir was together for, and that's not dating anyone, at a wonderful wedding to attend. She had to suffer in the Caribbean. But for the first time, we were back to, yeah, took one for the team. We were all together on Thursday, and we're all together here, and that hasn't happened since the beginning of March in 2020. Right? So I want to thank God for that one blessing.
I also want to say thank you for the opportunity to make that trip.
And I would like to give thanks to God that He has kept us all healthy so far.
Amen.
And now, let us center our hearts, our minds, and our souls on Almighty God, whom we worship. Our worship this morning is Holy Eucharist, Rite 2, beginning on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God
in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God,
heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our Bible readings.
In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem when she started to return with her daughters-in-law from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had considered his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud. Then they said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me." Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts me from you." When Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. For our song today, let's do the refrain together, and then I'm going to ask Mike to read the verses. So together the refrain.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in rulers, nor in any child of earth, for there is no help in them. When they breathe their last, they return to earth, and in that day their thoughts perish. Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the seas, and all that is in them, who keeps his promise forever, who gives justice to those who are oppressed, and food to those who hunger. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord cares for the stranger. He sustains the orphan and widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked. The Lord shall reign forever, your God, O Zion, throughout all generations. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
The second reading is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, verses 11 through 14. When Christ came as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy place, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls with the sprinkling of the ashes of a heifer sanctifies those who have been defiled so that their flesh is purified, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to worship of the living God? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our sequence one song this morning from Lift Every Voice and Sing, song number 74, Jesu, Jesu. Stand as you are able, please.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Christ.
One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first one is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no other commandment greater than these." Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and beside him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength the sermon, I have a challenge. We have read from Ruth this morning. Since we're celebrating All Saints next week, that's the only time we're going to read from Ruth in worship. It's a very short book. It's 4 or 5 chapters on 4 or 5 pages. That's it. I think somebody said 80 verses is all. So how about it? Go home and read the whole story of Ruth. Because where we usually hear it is at weddings, but it is not about weddings. So there's your challenge. I would start today by asking, when was the last time you felt backed into a corner or up against a wall or stuck between a rock and a hard place? Last year? Last month? Yesterday? Doesn't it seem like right now that our world is full of us being in those places? Our country is so divided, we can't seem to make headway on any issue at all. Civility is a word that seems to be as out of date as peachy keen. And St. John's is sitting here trying to figure out what our future will look like. To say nothing of the diocese doing exactly the same thing. All of these together can make our times an uncomfortable place to be. And frankly, my first response, the unthinking one, is to be angry about it all. That doesn't solve anything. But at least if I express my anger, it brings my blood pressure down a little bit. Then maybe I can start to find a way where it seems that there is no way. Right up front, I need to remember that I am not doing this work alone. God is always there, whatever my struggles. So I am not discovering a way so much as listening for God's way. What could it be? How can I find God's way? One way is to think through 3 questions that were beautifully phrased this week by the Reverend Diane Strickland on the Reverend Rev Gal Blog Pals website. The first one is, in this time, when I'm not sure I can find a way, who do I want to be with? The second one is, how did we find a way before? And where is a door that we haven't opened yet? And the third one is, does this way call forth the love of my heart, mind, soul, and strength so that I am loving God if I go this way? Believe it or not, those are what our readings are really all about. In our reading from the book of Ruth, we deal with the first question. Elimelech determines that finding food is more important than staying in his own country, and therefore he moves his family. After the death of all 3 men and the family leaving the women with no income or support systems, there are more decisions to be made about who to be with. It's clear that Naomi, Orpah, and Ruth care deeply for each other. Naomi decides to go back to Judah since the famine has passed there. She wants to be with familiar faces, perhaps even relatives. Ultimately, Orpah decides to return to her family, where perhaps another husband will be found for her. And Ruth decides to stay with Naomi no matter what. We can't judge any of these decisions. We don't know how things turn out for Orpah, for example. We don't know what would have happened if Elimelech stayed in the land of famine. But we can see how important it was for each person to figure out who they wanted to be with. Each decision led to a way forward when it seemed there was no way. And that is true for us, too. Is it more important for us to be with each other, to get along as a country, to learn to work together, or to be with others who agree that all of us are right on all those issues? Will we face St. John's future together, or will we scatter into separate groups, or even individuals, making independent decisions? Who do we want to be with for the long haul? Where can we find companions who will walk with us and sustain us through the tough times? Our reading from Hebrews, in language that doesn't seem particularly clear to our modern world, leads us to ask how we found a way before. And it gives us the all-important follow-up question, where is a door we haven't opened yet? All that language about sacrificing animals that really does sound strange to us was a normal part of religion at the time it was written, for the Jews and basically every other faith. So that was the way that people had found to follow God. And Christ, for them, was the door that had not yet been opened. The sacrifice given once for all, even for us, these thousands of years later. So, when times were tough before, what did St. John's do? My favorite story about St. John's history occurred sometime more than 100 years ago. It seems the church defaulted on its mortgage, and the bank took over the building and rented it out to a meat market. I'm not sure how that works, but that's the way the story goes. I think it's the first building, not this hall, or I'm not sure. The first building was on the other side of the tracks.
This parish.
This parish. St. John's, however, did not quit, even at this strange turn of events. Apparently, as the story goes, they sent out the prettiest young ladies in the congregation to solicit donations from the people and the businesses of Wellsville. And nickel by nickel, and dime by dime, those young ladies collected enough money to catch up the mortgage and reopen the church. Phyllis Jens told me this years and years ago. So keep it in mind, it's pretty unique history. I don't think that we're going to have much luck searching for lots of pretty young ladies and collecting nickels and dimes in solving our problems. But if that was the path that works, the question remains, where is there a door that we haven't tried? What other options are out there to help us learn to work together as St. John's Parish, as one nation, as people who respect each other? What are they? Where are they? And then there's our gospel reading. This reading comes at the conclusion of a section where Jesus has been faced by several hostile questioners, the religious leaders of the day. And today's reading is about one who is apparently not hostile, but sincere in his question. In modern terms, the scribe asks Jesus, what matters most in life? Jesus replies immediately with a very straight answer. No parables here. This is up front. Here is how it is. And he says that what matters most is God, who God is, and what God wants from us. And the scribe agrees, as we do too, I hope. So, as we look at how we can make our world better, as we look for doors to open that we have not considered before, as we consider pathways we simply could not see in earlier times, we need to ask if the way, the path that we are considering leads us closer to God. In whatever way that might be, can we see that path as a way in which we are loving God with everything we are and everything we have? Or is the pathway the temptation of self-gratification or simply comfort? Or is it the path of avoidance? And so this day I pray, Lord, help us to focus on these three questions as we live in the world as it is with today's problems. Guide us, Lord, to choose our companions wisely, to understand our past and be open to a different future. And Lord, be our North Star, the beacon light of our lives, so that you are the center of all we are. Let us affirm our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed as found on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father and Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of the one being of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear when we pray in the name of your Son. Therefore, in confidence and trust, we pray, saying, God of grace, and responding, hear our prayer. Father, enliven the church for its mission, that we may be salt of the earth and light to the world. Bless and strengthen Michael, our presiding bishop, Prince, our bishop, and Carol, our priest. Breathe fresh life into all your people, giving them the power to reveal Christ in word your hands those who have died in the faith of Christ, and those whose faith is known to you alone, especially those we name before you now. Give comfort to those who mourn. Bring them peace in their time of loss. We praise you for all your saints who have entered into your eternal glory. May their example inspire and encourage us. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Lord, you have called us to serve you. Grant that we may walk in your presence with your love in our hearts, your truth in our minds, and your strength in our wills, until at the end of our journey, we know the joy of our homecoming and the welcome of your embrace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our prayers for, or our songs for the preparation of gifts, 705 from the 1982 hymnal, As Those of Old Their First Fruits Promise.
Angels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this.
our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is high, Christ is risen.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve him in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as the Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our
against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia! Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. The post-communion prayer that's found in your bulletin. Gracious God, in the fellowship of your faithful people, wherever Holy Eucharist is celebrated, and of all of your faithful who are unable to receive this gift, we join our voices in thanksgiving for the mystery of your presence, not only in bread and wine, but also in us, the temples of our bodies. You have made us not only to receive Eucharist, but to become Eucharist, so that in our bodies and in the bodies of our neighbors, we would behold your face. Send us out, O Lord, from wherever we stand, to nourish this world with your life-giving presence, so that inhabited by grace, we might draw the world to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Carol made a suggestion earlier, if you feel so inclined, and I hope you do, take these home with you, and then you can look at the words and be a little bit more comfortable with them for the dedication. And also, please remember, we can vote on Tuesday. It's rather important. Isn't that correct? That's correct, because you were looking at me like I lost my mind. Our closing song is from 1982, 460, song 460, Aleluia, Sing to Jesus. We'll do verses 1 and 3, 1 and 3. Stand if you are able.
This is still running. This is still filming. Or recording.
Have a good day.
Have a great time.
I hope so, girl.
put your own. No, there won't be today. Numbers are too high in the county. Come now, you can be taller than that.